You might have heard of the term direct bilirubin and indirect bilirubin. What does that mean? I think most of you must be knowing that direct bilirubin means conjugated bilirubin and indirect bilirubin means unconjugated bilirubin. But why they are named so? Today I will explain you the exact reason behind this naming. Right? Hello, I am Dr. Aizaz from medicovisual.com. Welcome to this visual lecture. So let's suppose this is a macrophage. You know, in spleen and even outside the spleen, when RBCs are broken, hemoglobin is released. Hemoglobin consists of heme and globin. Globin is basically polypeptide chain. Globin chain is digested and converted into free amino acid. And here the heme, which comes into macrophages, which is taken up by macrophages, it is converted into bilirubin through a multi-step pathway, right? Why so? Because heme is a toxic substance. It can cause direct cell injury. It can even lead to multi-organ damage, especially it can cause kidney damage. Can lead to acute kidney injury, right? So macrophages, thankfully, they convert heme into bilirubin, right? Now this bilirubin should be excreted out of the body through feces. It is sent to intestine through blood and then it is lost into feces, right? Now when bilirubin comes into blood, here there is a problem. Actually, bilirubin is a non-polar substance. It's a non-polar hydrophobic lipophilic substance. You know, blood is 90% water. It's an aqueous medium. So when in aqueous medium, when in this water, this oily substance, this bilirubin is added, it coalesces together, it aggregates together and it starts sticking to the walls of blood vessel, I mean, right? So it is just like as if droplets of oil, they start floating on water, because that's a lipophilic substance. So here there is a problem, and the solution for this problem is that we have special transport vehicles for this, right? What is the name of this transporter? It is albumin. Albumin forcefully takes up this bilirubin and it can then transport to intestine, right? If albumin was not there, it will just keep sticking. Bilirubin will just keep sticking, scared of water. It will just keep sticking to the walls of blood vessels. Thankfully, albumin is there to take up this bilirubin in hydrophobic environment and to transport it to intestine. Now, when it will transport it to intestine, again, the problem is same. Intestine is full of water. Right? So when it will be sent into intestine, when it will be unloaded into intestine, again here it will be aggregated and it will coalesce together, and again it will stick to wall of intestine and it won't be excreted. So what should be done? One thing that can be done is that this albumin, it takes up this bilirubin and it then drops it into feces, and in this way albumin will also be lost into feces. Of course, we don't want our precious trucks, our precious transporter to be easily lost into feces. So again, this is a problem. Well, we have our friend liver. So liver solves the problem. Liver says, don't worry, just give this bilirubin molecule to me. I will do something with this molecule and then this molecule will be lost into intestine, into feces, without need of losing this albumin. So what liver does? This reminds me of something. When I was in high school, there was a very wise teacher. What she used to do is that there were, of course, some academically weak students in our class. She paired up those academically weak students with some brilliant, hard-working students. Right? Then when these weak students were paired up with those brilliant students, they also started working hard and their grades went up. So that's the idea which this liver follows. Liver is like a wise teacher, I think. What liver does is that liver pairs up, liver conjugates this bilirubin with this weakly polar bilirubin with a strongly polar substance. And what is this strongly polar substance? That is glucuronic acid. So liver attaches two molecules of glucuronic acid with bilirubin, and now this bilirubin becomes bilirubin diglucuronide. Now a question, that here this was bilirubin which was loaded on these trucks. Is this bilirubin conjugated bilirubin, or this bilirubin is conjugated bilirubin? This glucuronide, this bilirubin diglucuronide is conjugated bilirubin. Actually, when I was kid, I thought that as soon as bilirubin is attached with albumin, it is conjugated bilirubin. It is not conjugated bilirubin, it is unconjugated bilirubin, because it is not chemically bound with it, it is not covalently bound with it. This bilirubin, which is covalently conjugated with two molecules of glucuronide, this bilirubin is called conjugated bilirubin, and this bilirubin is unconjugated bilirubin, which was loaded on albumin, right? So now that this highly hydrophobic substance is bound with glucuronic acid, two molecules of glucuronic acid, now it has become slightly polar, and now it has become slightly polar hydrophilic. Now it can be easily lost into intestine without any help from albumin, and now it will be secreted into intestine through bile duct, right? And it will be lost into feces. Now let me tell you an experiment. Now let's suppose this is a container, and in this we add plain water, and in this plain water, when we add this conjugated bilirubin, it will be easily dissolved. Why? Because it's a polar substance, right? Now let's take a container, and in this container, now we add a special substance into this container, and this substance is called diazosulfanilic acid. For medical students, I don't think you need to remember the name, the chemical name, but at least remember that this substance is called Vandenberg Reagent, on the name of a scientist, Abraham Vandenberg, who was pioneer of this technique which I am explaining right now, right? So this agent is added, this reagent is added into water, and now in this solution, if we add conjugated bilirubin, this conjugated bilirubin and this reagent, it will quickly, swiftly react with each other, and it will form a purple substance that is chemically called azo derivative of bilirubin, right? And due to formation of this purple colored substance, this solution will turn purple in color, right? Color will turn purple. Now the intensity of color, it depends upon, it is directly proportional to concentration of bilirubin. If more bilirubin is there, color will be more intense. If very less bilirubin is there, I mean conjugated bilirubin, color will be less intense, right? Now depending upon, on the basis of intensity of color, on the basis of intensity of purple color, we can compare it with the standard and we can estimate the concentration of bilirubin present. Of course, if color is more intense, it means more bilirubin is present, right? So we can estimate the bilirubin by this method. Now, because this bilirubin directly reacted with this reagent, it directly reacted with Vandenberg reagent, this reaction is called direct Vandenberg reagent reaction, direct Vandenberg reaction, and this conjugated bilirubin is called direct bilirubin, right? Now let's repeat the experiment again. Now in water, first we add, what is this reagent? Vandenberg reagent. And now rather than adding conjugated bilirubin, now we add unconjugated bilirubin, free bilirubin. Now as soon as this free bilirubin is added, scared of water, it will quickly come together, the molecule will come together and hug each other, right? So they will coalesce together and they will form this oily droplet on the surface of water. So now this reagent, can it react with this? It can react, but it will react very slowly, right? First it will react with this outer layer of molecule, then it will go inside. Actually it has become like this, that this is an outer layer, then inner layer of molecule, then another inner layer of molecule, and ultimately the core. So first these molecules of Vandenberg reagent, first they will come and react with this outer layer, then this inner layer, and then this inner layer, and so on. Reaction will be very very slow. Here in case of direct, because the molecule was spread evenly, molecules of conjugated bilirubin were spread evenly, surface area was quite high, surface area was large. Because of this, it quickly, swiftly reacted without adding any catalyst, without doing anything. But here reaction will be very very slow, right? So in this, when we add a catalyst, and catalyst for this reaction is methanol, when we add few drops of alcohol, methanol, 50% alcohol, it acts as catalyst, and now it will quickly react and color will turn purple. Now you see, in case of unconjugated bilirubin, the reaction was very very slow unless we added a catalyst, methanol. So reaction proceeded indirectly after addition of catalyst, after addition of methanol. So that's why this type of reaction is called indirect Vandenberg reaction. And the unconjugated bilirubin which undergoes this reaction is called indirect bilirubin, right? Now let's test your knowledge. Let's suppose this is a container, and in this container plain water is added, and now first we add, let's say, this reagent, Vandenberg reagent, and then I add some bilirubin molecules. I don't know which bilirubin is this. And now when this bilirubin is added, within few seconds the color turns purple. The color turns purple. Which bilirubin was this? Direct bilirubin. Now when, let's suppose, concentration according to intensity, when we estimated the concentration of bilirubin, it turned to be, let's suppose, 7, right? Now we did something amazing. Now we, in this solution, we added methanol. And when we added methanol, intensity increased, right? Color intensity increased. And now, when we checked, when we estimated the bilirubin concentration, it turned out to be about 10. So this concentration 10 of bilirubin is which bilirubin? Conjugated or unconjugated? Unconjugated. No, it is not unconjugated. What is it? Can you tell? It is total bilirubin. Actually, what happened? This was actually a mixture of bilirubin. It was mixture of direct, not direct, let's forget about direct for sake of simplicity. It was mixture of conjugated and unconjugated bilirubin. Initially, what happened? Initially, immediately when bilirubin, this mixture was added, immediately conjugated bilirubin reacted and value turned out to be 7. Right, and unconjugated bilirubin remained behind, it didn't react, right? But when methanol was added, even unconjugated bilirubin also reacted and intensity increased, because unconjugated bilirubin also reacted, intensity increased, and now this total intensity 10 is actually the concentration of total bilirubin. From this total bilirubin, we can estimate, we can calculate the indirect bilirubin. How? Total bilirubin minus conjugated bilirubin. I think it's very easy to remember that 10 is total bilirubin, right? And out of this, the initially that reacted was 7. So, indirect bilirubin is about 3, right? Indirect bilirubin is so indirect that we do not directly measure it. We indirectly calculate it from total bilirubin. Are you clear about the equation, that how, from where this equation came? Are you really clear? So, in a nutshell, direct bilirubin is conjugated bilirubin and indirect bilirubin is unconjugated bilirubin. But now you know why. I have seen many students and even healthcare professionals remembering it like this, cramming it up like direct bilirubin, conjugated bilirubin, indirect bilirubin, unconjugated bilirubin, and on the day of exam they again forget it. You don't need to memorize this, my friends. It's very logical. You just need to understand the concept and then studies become very easy for you. Right, so this was about the Vandenberg reaction and direct and indirect bilirubin. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you like this video, please give a thumbs up, and please do subscribe to my channel and do check out my Facebook group. Also, please give your precious comments regarding this video. Thank you so much.